Could you possibly beat Pokémon Crystal if each and every move could only be used in a single battle? After trying and failing in Pokémon Red, we're moving on to Gen 2 to see how it goes. In Generation 1, only 165 moves existed. As of Pokémon Crystal, we're up to 251, and hopefully those extra 86 moves will make the difference. There are still a plethora of moves that won't be of any use, but we've got access to some good new attacks and some helpful status moves. The rules are fairly self-explanatory. If I use a move in battle after that matchup ends, that move is off-limits for the remainder of the game. I won't be using any items in battle other than held items, and this challenge basically makes grinding completely infeasible. There's not a lot of room for unnecessary battles here. The daycare is off-limits, so we can't walk our way to extra levels or moves. Finally, moves like Metronome, Mirror Move, Mimic, and others of that ilk count as solo moves. So, if we use Metronome and it becomes Flamethrower, that doesn't take Flamethrower off the table, only Metronome. That's all of the important stuff covered, so let's get into the challenge. We select Totodile as our starter as it has the best early moveset for our run and get straight into the first battle against Silver. As we chose the water starter, he grabbed Chikorita, which makes this a scratch versus tackle face-off. Thanks to our berry, it's a fairly easy win to start the run, which only takes one move off the table. It's probably a good time to discuss the day-night cycle, which we'll have to deal with throughout this run. Different Pokémon appear at different times, and in Pokémon Crystal, a lot of things are only possible on certain days. As it's night, we're able to catch a couple of Poliwag on Route 30 before getting into the only mandatory battle between us and Violet City. Any and all experience is vital here, so we get in a bit of switch training while taking down youngster Mikey's Pidgey and Rattata. It only takes the use of Bubble, so that's one more move gone, and it gets Totodile up to level 7 where he learns Rage. We pick up a few Geodude and various unknown forms in the nearby caves and then visit the Violet City Gym. There's strength in numbers, so our crew of level 4 Geodude take out Spearow using only Tackle to take us past the first mandatory gym trainer. In the second, our unknown knockout bird keeper Rod's Feathered Friends with Hidden Power, and having used just 4 moves, we've made it to our first gym battle. Totodile's only up to level 8, but Faulkner's famously terrible in Pokémon Crystal, so we should be okay. As it turns out, Rage is the only move we need to make it past the Violet City Gym Leader and take Totodile up to level 10. So, after using just 5 moves, we've taken down Faulkner and earned the Zephyr Badge. Good start! After leaving the gym, we received the Togepi Egg from Professor Elm's aid, and then catch ourselves some Growlithe before coasting down Route 32, which is completely free of mandatory battles. It's worth noting that Sprout Tower is entirely avoidable too, so we'll be without Flash, but it saves us a few moves, which is what matters most. In the Pokémon Center just outside the Union Cave, a fisherman gives us the Old Rod, so that will definitely come in handy. There's also an unnecessary battle with Hiker Daniel inside the cave, but his level 11 Onix is a great opportunity to get an extra level on Totodile. We take out the Quadweak Rocksnake with a Bellsprout Vine Whip and then delve deeper into the cave to pick up TM39's Swift. There isn't actually a single unskippable trainer between Faulkner and the Slowpoke Well Rocket Grunt, so let's just jump forward to Azalea Town. The first grunt down the well has a team of Rattata that are just about beatable with a pack of Biting Growlithe. One thing that's really difficult in the early game here is funding your Pokeball habits. As we're running a little bit short on decent attacks now, we're forced to make use of Togepi's Charm, Totodile's Leer, and a Growlithe Swift to make it past the second grunt. That takes our move total to 10 with a lot of battles in our near future. Already we're getting into a tough spot. Inside the well, we catch a few level 8 Zubat that are able to knock off grunt number 3 with the mind-numbingly slow combination of Leech Life and Supersonic. Okay, we've made it to the final grunt, and that means we're through the difficult part. As a reward for beating him, Faulkner gave us the TM for Mudslap, and in this pre-ability world, that's pretty deadly against coughing. The victory takes Totodile up to level 13 where he learns Water Gun, so we're in good shape for the difficult upcoming battles. Before getting into those, we spend a night fishing to relax and catch just a whole bunch of Tentacool and Goldene. That gives us access to Poison Sting and Peck, which could both be pretty vital if we're going to beat Silver and Bugsy. We start off against our rival because, honestly, I probably need some more moves to get through the gym, and he's blocking us from going into Ilex Forest. This whole run was so strategically planned, and yet I completely forgot to visit the forest before going into Slowpoke Well. Oops. In this one, we're switch training Togepi, and thanks to a bit of luck, make it past Ghastly with just Water Gun. When Silver sends out his newly evolved Bayleaf, we just start throwing piles of soggy jellyfish at him. Bayleaf, not Silver. Well, maybe both. Whatever the case, 3 Tentacool take down the best Johto Pokémon with Poison Sting, leaving Silver with only his Zubat. At this point, Togepi has learned Metronome, but we're saving that for later. Poison Sting chips away a tiny bit of HP, but ultimately Water Gun's just about enough to get us through, which earns a supreme sigh of relief. Prior to starting this challenge, I pinpointed this battle as a possible run-ender. To be clear, it was a massive issue, but we're through it now, so let's move on. After being given the Cut HM in Ilex Forest, we catch a horde of Oddish and then head to the Azalea Gym. In the opening battle, we need a little bit of help from Togepi's Growl, but Absorb gets us past the twins guarding the entrance. Here's a little look at why a lot of these battles need to be cut down. This was not a fun way to deal with Amy and May. It took 5 Growls and 56 uses of Absorb to defeat a Spinarak and a Ledyba. Believe me, you do not want to sit through all of that. We've got a choice of who to take on second here, and I opt for Bugcatcher Josh, who's only got a single Paris. Sadly, this is where I decided to use Metronome, so this is all we're gonna get to see of it. Togepi manages to conjure Dizzy Punch, Poison Sting, and Rolling Kick, which are pretty mixed, but the confusion damage destroys Paris, leaving only Bugsy. I went into this one with a pretty fixed plan of just schooling Bugsy with a Pectacular Goldeen performance. Like, schooling because of a school of fish? And Pectacular because we're only using Peck? No? Fine, that was bad, but it worked. The strategy, not the puns. So that's 19 total moves to get our second gym badge. This is how far we made it in Pokémon Red, but we're in a much better position this time around. There's nothing between us and Goldenrod City now, and we've added the TMs for Fury Cutter and Headbutt, so I'm feeling pretty positive. We use a Ghastly we caught earlier to knock off a Super Nerd with Lick, as his 2 Grimer only had Pound to attack. It was a free win, really. Then we grab the coin case and head for Route 35. You've got to be very careful here with almost every trainer violently spinning from the horrors they've seen, but it's possible to avoid the lot. In the National Park, we get the Quick Claw and the TM for Dig, and then as it's Tuesday, head back to the entrance to enter the bug catching contest. I didn't really mind what I caught here, both Scyther and Pinsir offered us new moves and high base stats, but instead on my first encounter, I found a shiny Weedle. I was about a split second away from running here before my brain kicked in and I noticed it was shiny. I was only really scanning for Scyther and Pinsir, so I'm actually shocked that I didn't just run immediately. As it was level 18, I just decided to go for it, even though it makes things more difficult because I am not waiting 2 days to keep playing. Somehow, and I'd like an explanation from those in charge of the bug catching contest, a shiny Weedle is only good enough to earn us third place. It's apparently less interesting than a Venonat. All I'm saying is I think money changed hands here. We nickname Weedle Bronze and then celebrate the fact that we now have access to String Shot. It's a real game changer. With that out of the way, we can now make our way to the gym where there's only one required trainer battle before Whitney. Against Last Carry's Snubbull, we call on Venonat's Disable, which really had no impact before taking down the normal type with Cut. Okay, now we've got to take on Whitney and her Miltank with our underleveled limited team, so wish me luck. Her level 18 Clefairy's up first, and we need 3 moves to make this work. For starters, we call on Ghastly to put her to sleep with Hypnosis, then switch out to Goldeen, whose Tail Whip lowers the Sleeping Fairy's defense, before finally finishing things with Totodile's Headbutt. We make it through the first portion of the battle largely unscathed, but now it's Whitney's Miltank across the battlefield. We go with the same strategy here, but this time add Bronze's String Shot into the mix. We get pretty lucky with Miltank sleeping for longer than expected, but after hours of trying, that was bound to happen eventually. At this point, Miltank just barreled through our team with a rollout, but we do at least get in an extra String Shot and Tail Whip. Most importantly, by the time our fifth Pokemon's fainted, Miltank's rollout has to reset, so Totodile's got a chance. We get unlucky with the second strike of rollout scoring a critical hit, but with 4 hit points remaining, Totodile's Headbutt flinches Miltank, meaning he can follow up with another attack. I don't think anything has ever been as clutch as that flinch right there. This one was unsurprisingly an absolute nightmare and well worth using the 4 moves required. After some crying from both of us, Whitney hands over the plane badge and even better than that, the TM for Attract. Once we receive the squirt bottle, we can go after Sudowoodo and catch level 20 who instantly improves our team. We add the TMs for Rock Smash and Nightmare and then get ourselves to Akrotik City. After a chance encounter with Bill, we add Eevee and a whole host of new Pokemon into our messy rotating roster of untrainable moveless heroes. Requiring the Firestone for the next part of my plan, we enter into another skippable battle against Schoolboy Alan. Our newly added Arbok's actually able to knock off Tangela with just Rap, but our new friend won't stop calling us about a rematch. Like he's actively refusing to give over a Firestone. So we return to knock out Tangela again, this time with Ledian's Comet Punch. Those 2 moves wouldn't have been massively useful going forward anyway, so hopefully this won't come back to bite me. Several hours of phone calls later, Alan finally picks up a Firestone, which we can use on one of our many new Growlithe. That evolution gets us an Arcanine, so now it's time for another rival battle against Silver. Leading off with his level 20 Haunter, Silver does a large part of our job for us by using Curse. That will be a recurring theme in Ekrateek. We manage to knock off the Ghost without losing a single Pokemon using only Ember. Zubat's up next and does much better than the Haunter, taking down two Growlithe before fainting. Arcanine watches on as a burn finishes off Zubat, and then after Silver starter knocks out another Growlithe, returns to battle to earn the plaudits once again. That leaves Silver with only his Magnemite, who also falls to Ember, and as we never even used one of our Growlithe, I'm sort of wondering if the whole Firestone thing was a waste of time. For the sake of my sanity, I'm just going to assume it was required. Anyway, Totodile evolves into Croconaw thanks to the switch training, which is nice, but we're going to leave the gym for later. The Ekrateek Dance Theater is our next port of call, where we start by battling Kimono Girl Zuki and her Umbreon. Machop's Karate Chop gets us the win there, taking our move total to 30, and also causes Bronze to evolve into a very sick-looking Kakuna. Sick by all definitions of the word. Flareon's next in line, and against him we'll be making use of our new Fearow's Fury attack. This is, of course, a cursed move, and I'd never use it unless strictly forced to, so I hope you will understand how many difficult spots you're left in during this challenge. Jolteon's up third, and it's here that we call on Magnemite for the very first time. There's basically no way for Jolteon to damage us, so Sonic Boom earns us a nice easy win and a bit more experience for Bronze. We call on the little magnet again when Kuni's Vaporeon comes out, and thanks to some terrible battle strategy, Thundershock's just about enough. That gains Bronze the final bit of experience required to level up, so we can get our third evolution in 5 battles. Shiny Beedrill looks so good. Was this a mistake that made this challenge harder? Probably, yeah, but was it worth it? Possibly? I don't actually know yet. Level 20 happens to be the level at which Beedrill learns Twin Needle, which is particularly useful when you've caught a level 18 Weedle. We give Bronze a chance right away against Espeon, and she two shots the psychic type with her new move. That's all for the Kimono Girl, so now we've got Surf in our arsenal, and it's probably time to head for the gym. Sage pings up first there, and his team of Ghastly almost curse themselves out of the battle against Eevee and Raticate, but the final one blocks our switch with Mean Look. That forces us to use a move, so instead of recalling Eevee, we do have to burn Sand Attack. Still, we made it through the battle without using any damage dealing moves, so that's still a success as far as I'm concerned. The second gym trainer is skippable thanks to a shortcut in the invisible floor, so let's check in with the third in line. Sage Jeffrey is clearly keen to outdo Ping, so he does exactly what we need, calling for Curse 3 times to hand us the win without using a single move. Medium Martha's the final gym trainer standing in our way, and we're using the same strategy. Our normal types switch back and forth, but this time we're locked into battle on 3 separate occasions and forced to use Foresight, Nightmare, and Roar. I made sure that we had plenty of moves on hand that weren't massively useful, so I could make it through the battle without wasting anything good. So we've made it all the way to Morty without using a proper attack, so yeah, I'm a big fan of the Ekrateek Gym. Before getting into the battle with Morty, we collect the odd egg from the daycare and hatch ourselves an Igglybuff. That gives us an extra normal type with unused moves just in case we need it. I feel like 90% of the time I play through Pokemon Crystal, I hatch either an Igglybuff or a Cleffa from this egg, which are usually the two I don't want. On this occasion, the only time where I actually wanted one of them, it took 11 tries to get one. To start the battle, Ghastly manages to prevent Igglybuff from having to use Dizzy Punch with a curse, so that was pretty nice. Morty's Haunter goes one better and knocks itself out with curse before we've even had to call for a move, but sadly, the gym leader's last two Pokemon don't even know how to use it. Still, with some luck on Hypnosis, Sudowoodo is able to knock out Gengar with Rock Throw and then does the same to Haunter too. So, without too many issues, we've beaten Morty with the use of only Rock Throw. That earns us another badge and the TM for Shadow Ball, so now we can head for Olivine City. There's only one mandatory battle on the road there, where we make use of Sudowoodo's Flail to take our total to 40. Once we've arrived in the Seaside City, we run some errands, grabbing the Good Raw, the HM for Strength, and then make our way up the Lighthouse to Jasmine. There are 3 unskippable trainers inside who burn Quick Attack, Gust, and Fury Cutter, but we really don't have time to show every meaningless battle anymore. Jasmine asks us to pick up some medicine in Cianwood City, but before we go there, we've got another shiny Pokemon in our sights. At the Lake of Rage, we go for a nice relaxing surf and cross paths with the Red Gyarados, who we eventually catch. On top of the new Pokemon, we also get a Red Scale, which we can trade to Mr. Pokemon in exchange for the experience share. That should speed things up, as I've been switch training different Pokemon for most of this run. Also, now that surfing's an option, we can catch a level 24 Golbat, a level 22 Raticate, and a level 24 Golduck. They all have some good moves which will be necessary if we're gonna make it through Chuck's gym. There are 4 trainers inside who can't be avoided, so we really needed to add some new moves. Anyway, that's all the prep done for Cianwood City, so let's pick up the secret potion and take on this gym. We've got back-to-back battles to start off our gym run with Black Belt Yoshi's Hitmonlee up first. Although it wasn't strictly the plan, our level 8 Igglybuff is able to knock off the level 27 fighting type. A wild jump kick basically does our job for us before Igglybuff puts him to sleep with Sing. It was actually a bit of a waste because Dizzy Punch would have won us the battle by itself. I really had no idea that Hitmonlee was going to do that though. Anyway, with Sing and Dizzy Punch, Igglybuff picks up an unlikely win, so let's see how we fare against Black Belt Lao's Hitmonchan. The fighting type gets revenge for Hitmonlee by thunder punching Igglybuff into oblivion before Raticate gets to work with Hyper Fang. That's the only move required to defeat Lao's Hitmonchan, and we can skip over the next two battles where Golbat's Confuse Ray and Golduck's Confusion earned us the wins. When our gym battle comes around, we use Gyarados for the first time and just call for Thrash. It absolutely obliterates Primate, but things take a little longer against Poliwrath thanks to Hypnosis. We actually cut it pretty close in the end, with Gyarados breaking through Confusion to get us the win. That takes our badge total to 5 right before our move total hits 50. For what it's worth, there's no way I'm doing this in future generations anytime soon. This challenge is incredibly difficult to plan and keep track of, and based off the first one is also massively unpopular. I really like it conceptually, but I guess in execution it doesn't really draw viewers. Anyway, we got Fly while I was complaining, which thankfully brings an end to all of the maneuvering through spinner-filled routes. We bring the secret potion back to Jasmine so she returns to her gym, but we're not ready to take her on just yet. Instead, we head for Mahogany Town where we've got more Rocket Grunts to deal with. On the first underground level, there are only 3 mandatory battles, so we make it through with just Mimic, Vice Grip, and Rock Smash. Then we shut down the remaining pillars at the computer and power through the rest of the Rocket Hideout. We get through the remaining Rocket battles using Low Kick, Thief, Fly, and Dragon Rage, and then shut down their contraption by catching the 3 level 23 Electrode. There really wasn't much worth watching in there, so let's move on to the Mahogany Gym and take on Price. We make use of the 3 Electrode we just captured here and combine Screech and Self-Destruct to completely annihilate the gym leader's team of 3. That earns us gym badge number 6, and as it's now Sunday, we can return to Goldenrod City to grab the TM4 Return. After that, we go back to Olivine City where we battle Jasmine with Gyarados. At level 33, the Shiny Serpent's suitably set up to succeed with only Seraph against Steelix & Co. That takes our totals up to 60 moves used and 7 badges earned, so we can now head through the ice path to Blackthorn City and catch a whole host of new Pokemon. Just to run through them quickly, we grab a level 30 Ursaring and a level 30 Donphan in the Dark Cave and on Route 45 respectively. Then we go back to Route 44 for a level 26 Lickitung and into the ice path for Swinub and Delibird. Seriously, I was catching Pokemon for a really long time. The day-night cycle also made it quite confusing. We head back to Route 44 for a Weepinbell and then re-return to Route 45 for Graveler. Finally, we pick up an Entei on Route 44 who should offer something to the... no, not really. I did run into it randomly though. Finally, we catch a level 28 Poliwhirl because I could not find any at level 29, I spent like an hour and a half searching and I don't think they exist. The reason for this massive haul of new Pokemon is the upcoming Radio Tower Rocket Takeover. There are an obscene number of mandatory trainer battles in front of us, so I had to add any and every Pokemon with an unused move. On our first run up the tower, we had 8 unskippable battles, including the Fake Director at the top. In that sequence, we burned through Dynamic Punch, Present, Stomp, Whirlpool, Dig, Faint Attack, Sleep Powder, Acid, and Waterfall. Believe me, if you want this video to not be like 4 hours long, we have to skip all of the Rocket Grunts. The guy up top has a decent team, but Waterfall was a really solid move to have with all of our water types. Although I don't actually think we needed more than just Gyarados. Weepinbell's Poison Powder and Igglybuff's Sweet Kiss and Pound then get us past the 2 unavoidable trainers in the underground. They're both battles intended for your first trip to Goldenrod City, so it wasn't too much of a challenge. Igglybuff's been surprisingly useful during this run. Anyway, that takes us into the fourth rival battle with Silver, where his team's actually really good. Thankfully, we've got some good Pokemon too, and I've got a workable strategy here. We lead off with Wobbuffet, who I'm now thinking I forgot to mention, against Silver's Golbat and call for Miracoat, knowing a bite is likely coming. The super effective move deals a decent chunk of damage, which works out perfectly for us as Wobbuffet deflects back double for a one-shot. Silver calls on Sneasel next, and as he's immune to Miracoat, we switch out to Ursaring and call for Fury Swipes. A lot of luck following a Faint Attack hands us another win, taking Silver down to 3. We go back out to Wobbuffet against Magnemite and use Miracoat again for another win. Haunter's out 4th, but I feel like you all know how to deal with ghost types by now. Haunter double curses itself into unconsciousness, meaning only Meganium remains. We switch in and out to remove the curse and then go all out with Fury Swipes. We get incredibly lucky with the number of strikes, but this was like attempt 50, so we had to get there eventually. It was that unfortunate situation where I could tell it was doable with just Miracote and Fury Swipe, so I had to keep trying. Oh my god, we're still not even halfway through this rocket sequence. Right, after taking down Silver, we can head through the rest of the underground section. In the first room, there are six unavoidable trainers who force us to use Double Slap, Twister, Rollout, Rest, Snore, and Magnitude. That takes us above 80 moves used, and now that we've got access to the move deleter in Blackthorn, it's the ideal time to make use of Struggle. We exhaust the PP for defense curl in a wild battle against a Metapod and then return to Goldenrod and head into the next room. We actually also wasted all of our hardened PP in another wild battle, but that was completely unnecessary because Donphan's Struggle was enough to take out Raticate and Golbat. After that battle, there are only two remaining trainers in the warehouse, the first of whom goes down to Powder Snow. Thankfully, the final grunts only got a couple of coughing, so with enough switching, we're able to convince him to call for self-destruct twice. Honestly, in this challenge, it's more exciting to get through a battle without using a move than it is to find a shiny Pokemon. Okay, that's all for the underground warehouse, let's head back to the radio tower. The first grunt inside uses the duo of Raticate and Koffing, so it's a perfect setup for Wobbuffet to use counter. Seriously, Wobbuffet has so few uses in regular runs of Pokemon games, but in this challenge it was an absolute godsend. On the next floor, the Rocket Executive with a Golbat further proves that by giving us another one move win with Destiny Bond. We break out Strength for the next Rocket Executive battle, which makes for an easy win, and finally takes us to the last Team Rocket battle of the game. We decide to make use of Return for this suitably happy occasion, and it one-shots Houndour easily, then two-shots Koffing and Houndoom. 89 moves deep, and we are finished with Team Rocket. We are running seriously short on moves, though. After taking down the first Blackthorn Gym Trainer with Icy Wind, I realized I needed to track down Entei and Raikou for some extra moves. I'll tell you right now, this was a fun day. And that was a lie, it was awful. There's no way to get Spiderweb or Meanluck on a Pokemon fast enough to help out, so we've got one ball to throw every time we meet them. In hindsight, I could have given Ghastly a Quick Claw and up my chances a little bit, but it wouldn't have helped too much. The only new move that Entei brings with it is Fire Spin, which is underwhelming, but it's something, I guess. Raikou was even worse to find because I hadn't encountered it before, so I was going in completely blind. It's a long process, but once we add Raikou, we have access to nothing. Oh, well, it learned Spark at level 41, so in the long run, I still think this was a good choice. We return to the Blackthorn Gym after our two new additions and break them out straight away. Using the Iron Tail TM that Jasmine gave us earlier, Entei clobbers a Seadra to get us going. Then, after using a rare candy on Raikou, the third gym trainer's team is wiped by Spark. I really didn't want to break out the TM for Ice Punch before getting to Claire, but none of our high-leveled Pokemon have hands, so we can only really teach it to Poliwhirl. It's a close call, but after a few tries, he's able to get us the win there, leaving only the gym leader. For this one, I had to spend some time gambling. Once we'd earned enough coins in the game corner, I could buy the TM for Blizzard and teach it to Gyarados. After using a couple of PP ups we'd found to raise it from 5 to 7, we challenged Claire to a battle. All three of her Dragonairs fall to Blizzard in a single shot, taking us into a one-on-one against Kingdra with 4 power points remaining. Blizzard isn't super effective against a partial water type, so it only cuts away about 40% of her HP. Claire counters by calling for Smokescreen, but in spite of that, Gyarados connects once more. When Kingdra spouts out more smoke, I decide to switch in and out because it feels like our accuracy luck has to run out eventually. After letting Kingdra knock out Donphan, we get a free switch back into Gyarados, whose Blizzard comes up just short of the knockout. Luckily for us, Claire calls for Hyper Beam, which isn't enough to knock off Gyarados, but the recharging move means she can't heal. Blizzard connects for the 7th consecutive time, handing us the win and almost earning us the final Johto Gym badge. More on that in a second. In case you're wondering, the odds of Gyarados hitting with Blizzard 7 times in a row once while under the effect of a smokescreen is just a touch over 6%. That was my first attempt. I have no idea how that happened. Anyway, Claire sends us to the Dragon's Den before we can have the Rising Badge, so Cool Trainer Darren will actually be our Johto send-off instead of the Blackthorn Gym Leader. Mostly just as an excuse to bring back Bronze, I taught her Sludge Bomb knowing that we could get over the line with a nice healthy poisoning. For this to work, I needed Dragonair to go for Slam and miss, and then also get lucky with Sludge Bomb only having a 30% chance of poisoning the foe. Clearly I'd used up all my luck with Claire because this took forever. It was a terrible idea. Eventually though, with move number 95, we conquer the Johto region and we can head for Kanto. Before leaving, we grab the Master Ball from Professor Elm, but that's it. We can now leave Johto behind and explore Routes 26 and 27 in peace. There are trainers everywhere here preparing for the surprisingly tame Victory Road, but only one of them is unavoidable. She goes down pretty easily to a few Raticate with Pursuit who we caught nearby. Let's have a look at some of the other new Pokemon we caught, most of whom are old Pokemon we caught at a higher level. There's Arbok and his Glare, Raticate and his Pursuit, done with that, although there's also Scary Face as an option. Dodrio is equipped with the very useful Tri Attack, Golbat's got Wing Attack, Sandslash has, well, Slash, and a few others that I didn't record for some reason. Anyway, after all of that, we're actually going right back to Johto because we really desperately need Suicune. I weighed up all of the options and it definitely seemed worth it to go through the three trainers guarding him. In the first battle, we ignore all of the new moves we just added in favor of Sleep Talk. Yeah, this one took a while. All three sages lead off with a level 32 Noct Owl, and they had to call for Hypnosis eventually. Gyarados sleepily bulldozes its way through Noct Owl and Flareon with Strength and Waterfall, but for the purposes of this challenge, that only counts as Sleep Talk. Then I had to lose the next battle without using a move, which, why didn't I bring the other Pokemon I needed? I knew these were back-to-back-to-back battles, but I literally brought a team to lose with rather than a team to win with. Don't know what I was thinking there. One of our other new additions takes on the second trainer, that being Quagsire, and his Slam. It makes for a fairly easy win against Sage Master's Noct Owl and Jolteon, taking us to 98 moves used and leaving us one battle away from Suicune. Dodrio's Tri-Attack is our chosen move for the final battle and it does a brilliant job. I'll save you the 3 hours of battles with Suicune where I attempted to catch it with Pokeballs, Great Balls, and Ultra Balls because it was just not happening. I eventually got sick of trying and just used the Master Ball when I realized there was every chance I'd never actually get an opportunity to use it otherwise. I wasn't really keeping track at the time, but move number 100 was Constrict, and I used it in the Skipple battle back in the Lighthouse in Olivine City. After number 101, Sandstorm got us past another avoidable trainer, we got ourselves a free rare candy which I thought on balance was probably worth it. Alright, with all of that out of the way, let's get into the final battle separating us from the Elite Four. Right at the end of Victory Road, Silver comes back for one last face-off. We've had a pretty okay time with him so far, so let's get into it. The battle begins with Entei facing Sneasel, which doesn't seem like a massively fair fight. It basically sees Firespin taking on Fury Cutter, and Firespin comes out so far on top. When Silver sends out his Golbat, we switch in Sandslash and call for Slash. The ground type gets chomped on a couple of times, but Slash gets us through that one too. Meganium's up next, and we make another switch, this time sending out Weepinbell. Its only remaining move is Stun Spore, but that's all it really needs. After paralyzing Meganium, he returns to his bowl for a well-deserved rest. Entei comes back out and gets straight back to Spinning Hot Fire. It's such a terrible attack that even as a legendary Pokemon with a level advantage and a super effective move, fighting a paralyzed flower, it only just about gets us the win. That actually takes Gyarados up to level 40, giving us access to Hydro Pump, which is a nice move to learn right before the Elite Four. I don't feel like I really need to tell you what happened against Haunter, we're what, half an hour into this? You know what Haunter did. To expedite the process, we use Fire Spin when Haunter's at 1 HP rather than waiting for a third curse. Silver calls on his Kadabra Fifth, and we paralyze it with Weepinbell and then switch around for a bit waiting for Future Sight. Gyarados takes the hit, and then we're all good to send Sandslash back out. Slash is good for a two-shot, taking Silver down to one, but we're forced to call on Gyarados again with another Future Sight coming. Up against Magneton now, we go out to Sandslash predicting an electric attack and then move on to Weepinbell to paralyze it. Stun Spore was incredibly useful here. After Weepinbell faints, we get our free switch into Entei and get to work with Fire Spin. Magneton actually manages to get off a Thundershock that paralyzes the legendary beast, and thanks to a few off-target Fire Spins, seriously, it's just an awful move, even scores the knockout. Luckily, Sandslash is on hand to clean up Entei's mess, and we make it through our final rival battle with only Fire Spin, Stun Spore, and Slash. I'm pretty proud of that one, honestly. So, it took me 104 moves to make it to the Elite Four, which is pretty good. We don't have a lot left now though, and have to successfully build a team of 6 who can get through 5 tough battles. Let's see what we've got. Alright, after lots of fun Game Corner time, this is the team I settled on for our Hall of Fame attempt. At level 41, we've got Raikou with Just Thunder. One level lower at 40, we've got our stalwart Gyarados with Hydro Pump, Dragon Breath, Thunder, and Fire Blast. Suicune ate up all of our rare candies to reach level 45, where it knows Bubble Beam, Rain Dance, and Aurora Beam. Also Surf, but we've already used that. Entei is still at level 40 and it knows Fire Blast and Solar Beam. Another victory road capture, we've got Graveler at level 40 with Earthquake and Harden, although Harden's already been used. Painfully, Graveler learns EQ at 41, but I had to spend a TM to teach it at 40 instead. Last up, we've got our level 34 Golbat with Wing Attack, Attract, Swagger, and Detect. I spent so long walking with Golbat that despite never seeing a battlefield, it basically has to be happy enough to evolve, so hopefully it'll be a Crobat soon. Out of interest, do you know how far you have to walk to get a Pokemon from base happiness to the point where they're happy enough to evolve? About 19.2 miles, so not too bad. Anyway, that is it. There's our team. Let's give this a try. We get things started against Will's Psychic type team with Raikou and Call for Thunder. It connects with Zatu number 1 at the first time of asking for a one-shot, so pretty perfect start. Jinx is next in line and Raikou's Thunder lands once more, this time paralyzing the opponent. The paralysis prevents Jinx from attacking, allowing another knockout before we've even been hit. When Will sends out Exeggutor, we switch into Gyarados, hoping to save Raikou for later. It's not the best showing, but Gyarados does manage to leave Exeggutor paralyzed and below half health before falling to Psychic. Raikou then returns to battle, and thankfully Gyarados has done enough that one final Thunder causes the knockout. I was worried that I may need an extra move to make it past the grass type, but with two powerful Thunder users, we made it through okay. Raikou obliterates the final two Pokemon on Will's team, both of whom are weak to electric attacks. So, with only one move used, we've made it past the first Elite Four member. Nice. As expected, Golbat evolves at the end of the battle, so even though it's super low level, it's at least more usable now. Anyway, let's see how the Koga battle goes. We lead off with Entei against the former gym leader's Ariados, and Fire Blast just instantly obliterates the spider. When Fortress comes out, we switch to Gyarados, who one-shots the Quad Weak Bug with a Fire Blast of his own. To make up for his failure against Will, Gyarados pulls out all the stops against Muk. Poisoned and weak, the Sea Serpent earns a second knockout to take Koga down to 2. We call on Entei once more when Koga's Crobat comes out, and although the legendary beast misses a Fire Blast, it still picks up an easy win. Venomoth's up last, and as it's weak to Fire-type moves, it only takes one more shot and we're onto the third Elite Four member. Bruno starts out with Hitmontop as we call on Crobat for the first time. The Wing Attack she starts with is a one-shot critical hit, so pretty good start. As she's woefully ill-equipped to deal with Onix though, we switch out to Entei for Bruno's second Pokemon. After taking in Sunlight and being ever so slightly bound, Entei fires off a Solar Beam that obliterates Onix. We stick with Entei against Bruno's Machamp and deal a good chunk of damage with Solar Beam before being knocked out by a Rock Slide. Crobat then returns to battle and thanks to Entei only requires one Wing Attack to take down Machamp. Not sure if that critical hit was necessary, but apparently that's all Crobat does. Hitmonchan avoids a crit on Wing Attack and counters with an Ice Punch, but as we're pre-physical special split, it's pretty pathetic. Crobat earns the knockout and then pushes on with the same attack against Hitmonlee. This time it's a one-shot without need for a crit, so after only 4 moves, we've defeated 3 quarters of the Elite Four. Karen starts off with her Umbreon and we send out Crobat. We're now onto the Swagger portion of the run. We jump back and forth between that and Detect and slowly whittle Umbreon's HP down. After we run out of PP for Detect, we switch to Attract, but still, our only way to deal damage is through Confusion. In the end, we manage to stall for long enough that Umbreon knocks himself out, so this strategy might just work. When Karen calls on her Gengar, we switch out to Graveler and call for Earthquake. As we've always relied on, the Ghost goes for Curse, guaranteeing EQ will be good for a KO, so Karen's already down to 3. We bring Crobat back out for the Vileplume face-off and return to the Swagger strategy. Attract's no longer a viable move, but we still use it as a way to stall. After dealing some good damage, we switch Graveler back into battle and end things with another Earthquake. Karen's penultimate Pokemon is her ace Houndoom, and thanks to the Quick Claw finally coming up trumps, we're able to score another win. That leaves Karen with only her Murkrow. The flying typing means we're relying on Swagger, but that's worked so far. Honestly, after all the failed attempts here, I was ready to come in with Bubble Beam or Hydro Pump if required, but Crobat gets us through, so it took 4 moves, but Karen is defeated. The Elite Four are done. Lance is the only one standing between us and the Hall of Fame. The only man separating us from the credits rolling. Alright, we get things started with a good old-fashioned Blue Gyarados versus Red Gyarados face-off. After Dragon Breath leaves Lance's Gyarados paralyzed, we make a switch out to Suicune, who's hopefully going to prove me right for using all of those rare candies. We get going with Aurora Beam, and after 3 Icy Blasts, Suicune gets us the first win of the match. Lance's first Dragonite takes an Aurora Beam on entry, but it just lives the hit. Luckily, it then fails to connect with Thunder Wave, so Suicune picks up another win. On the next Dragonite, I spent lots of time making some confusing switches that get us literally nowhere before running back the exact same sequence from the first Dragonite face-off. After more random switching, we get Suicune back into battle with Lance's Ace, confused and locked into Outrage. We know that two blasts of Aurora Beam will be enough for the knockout, but after one, Lance breaks out a full restore. In the end, it doesn't even matter as Suicune scores a critical hit on the second attempt. Aerodactyl is Lance's second to last Pokemon, and it deals some good damage with Ancient Power, but Bubble Beam gives Suicune another victory. That leaves only Charizard, and with Bubble Beam and Hydro Pump still in play, I'm actually feeling confident for the first time. With 3 hit points remaining, Suicune wipes out the Firestarter with a flurry of bubbles, earning us the win against Lance, so we've officially beaten Pokemon Crystal. Sort of. Not really, though. It took us a total of 115 moves to make it to the first credit screen, with only 11 used on the Elite Four and Champion. Still, it wouldn't really be Pokemon Crystal if I didn't do all of the Kanto stuff, so let's just see if this is possible. After grabbing the SS ticket from Professor Elm, we head back to Ecruteak City to see if we can capture ourselves a Ho-Oh. Now, rather stupidly, Ho-Oh and Lugia can't even get their signature moves in Crystal because they've already forgotten them by level 60. That's incredibly inconvenient for us, but they're still powerful Pokemon and I'll be trying to capture both. After receiving the Rainbow Wing, we climb to the top of Tin Tower and challenge Ho-Oh. We start by paralyzing the Rainbow Pokemon with Glare and then get to work with throwing balls. After a few hours of failed attempts, I just started using Speed Up because I was starting to lose my mind. Rather frustratingly, it only took like 15 balls from that point for me to make the catch, so it really felt like the game was just rubbing it in. There's only one mandatory battle on the SS Aqua, and that's against a Sailor with a Machop, a Machoke, and a Psyduck. We were almost completely out of moves at this point, so I had to go for Gyarados' Hydro Pump because I didn't think Noctowl's takedown would be quite enough. It gets us through the battle easily enough though, so let's get into the Kanto region proper. Fun fact, there were more mandatory battles in that Radio Tower Rocket sequence than there are in the entire Kanto region, so we shouldn't need too many more moves. We start by heading east of Cerulean City to Route 9, where there's just the one unavoidable trainer. This actually took a few tries, but it's just about doable with Noctowl's takedown. That's actually the only battle I did on this trip to the region. We head to the power plant to see what's going on there, and then return to Cerulean City to find the machine part. After collecting it from the gym, we head back to the power plant to fix things there and grab the TM for Zap Cannon. Then we take the train back to Johto, partly because I never got the radio, but also it's Wednesday, which is the only day that you can meet the move tutor. We pay 4,000 coins to teach Ho-Oh Flamethrower and then cross the border back to Kanto again. Seriously, the day-specific events were very inconvenient for a challenge like this. Anyway, as we've got the power plant up and running again, we get the radio card so we can play the Pokéflute to Snorlax and get ourselves another good Pokémon. After catching the normal type, we travel through Diglett's Cave to Pewter City, where we're gifted the Silverwing. That prompts another jet lag inducing journey back to Johto so we can blindly walk through the Whirl Islands. We skipped over Sprout Tower at the beginning, so there's no flash. Luckily, I can play this game in my sleep for the most part, so I don't really need it to find my way to Lugia. I got impatient with Lugia even faster than I did with Ho-Oh. I only tried for like an hour before I started using Speed Up, and it was once again a pretty quick catch after that. This challenge just hated me. Okay, you know the drill at this point, back to Kanto. This time we're actually doing a gym battle, so that's exciting, right? We start off in Saffron City against Sabrina because our current moves fit best for a battle with her. We take on the Psychic type specialist with just Snorlax. At level 50, the normal type knows Body Slam, which is a pretty great move to use against Sabrina's low defense trio. Anyway, it's an easy one move victory to start our Kanto gym challenge, so let's jump back to Pewter City, which should be another simple gym. With a couple of Tangela, we take down Brock's gym trainer using only Bind, and then travel approximately 0.000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000000 quick that you can just grab a random level 35 Tangler and sweep someone like Brock with a Mega Drain. I sort of just felt bad for him in the end. That was kind of sad. Anyway, moving on. The Nugget Bridge trainers did me in back in Pokémon Red, which feels like it was about 4 years ago now. They've relocated to Route 25, but they are mandatory once again as you can't get Misty back in her gym without battling them. Defeating them this time around was just a matter of finding Pokémon with unused moves to take advantage of, because our good Pokémon and good moves need to be saved. For the 7 unskippable trainers who make up literally a third of the Kanto region battles, we burn Larvitar's Rock Slide, Sea King's Horn Attack, Grimer's Sludge, Mr. Mime's Thunder Punch, Fearow's Mirror Move, Mr. Mime's Fire Punch, and Quillfish's Pin Missile. With that whole run of trainers defeated, we can interrupt Misty's date because clearly Pokemon battling is more important. That whole setup might make you think we're prepping to take on Misty, but no, Janine's up next. In a series of unimpressive gym leaders, Janine tops the lot. None of her team members even crack level 40, which is helpful when there's a Super Rod lying around and a hookable Pokemon with an Oko move. This is another one that leaves you feeling just a little bit embarrassed for the gym leader. Guillotine carries us to another easy victory for our third Kanto gym badge. Only 5 to go, starting with Blaine. Janine gives us the TM for Toxic, which is more or less a free win which we immediately cash in against the Cinnabar gym leader. So only 4 to go. We use a rare candy we acquired on one of our Krabby to evolve it into Kingler and get the move Crab Hammer in one fell swoop. We needed a move to take down the one unavoidable gym trainer guarding Lieutenant Surge, and although it didn't make a lot of sense to go with the water type for this one, it did end up being good enough to get us through. Again, you'd think that would put Surge next in line, but nope, we're headed to Celadon City to take on 3 more gym trainers. The distribution of mandatory trainer battles in this region is complete and utter lunacy. I do not understand it at all. Anyway, Ho-Oh's Steelwing tears through a Victory Bell and a Vileplume to start us with an easy win, but the second battle's a trickier proposition. We're running seriously short on usable moves at this point. A lot of the wild Pokemon levels in Kanto are a complete joke, so we have to take what we can get and Clamp is something we have available. Now, it's not the ideal move to take down an Exeggutor, so we had to work out how we could make it work. The ultimate answer was by using Thunder Wave and Protect in conjunction with it. Even then, this one took a lot of tries. Once I'd settled on the strategy, it wasn't too long because we did at least have a 4 level advantage. I did briefly consider returning to battle Fisherman Tully to try to get a Water Stone, but we really didn't have any moves to waste at this point. Anyway, Clamp gets us the win in the end, with that battle taking our move total to 135. For the final mandatory gym trainer, we use our 2 remaining rare candy on Rhydon to get her Horn Drill and then run with another Oko battle. This one was a little more specific because we needed to hit with 3 out of 5, but we got there eventually and that calls for a celebration. That is the final unskippable random trainer. We've only got boss battles from here on out. As she's right next to us, we start with Erica and select Ho-Oh's Shadow Ball as the move to use. There are so few usable moves left for us that picking the right move for each battle is more vital than ever now. We've got a massive level advantage here, so even though it's not super effective or stab, it gets the job done. Erica hands over the TM for Giga Drain so we can finally take on Misty. Again, Ho-Oh may not seem like the most sensible selection here, but it can learn Giga Drain and it's powerful enough to make use of it. Like the battle with Horn Drill, power points were the main issue here, but thanks to Misty only using 4 Pokemon, we're actually fine. 5 Mega Drains hand us the win, so let's move on to Surge. Ho-Oh's in the spotlight once more, but for the first time, the Rainbow Pokemon is actually allowed to use a Fire-type move. We splash the cash on Flamethrower, and it's the remaining move that makes the most sense. It hands us a simple victory, so now we're down to the final 2 battles of the game, and unlike most of the Kanto trainers, these ones are actually tough. In Viridian City, we take on Blue for our final Kanto gym battle and see if we can win it using only Psychic. On top of the free TM, you can purchase it in Celadon City, so we've taught it to Lugia, Ho-Oh, and Snorlax. The normal type isn't a great special attacker, so ends up falling to the Sandstorm set up by Rhydon. Lugia finishes off Gary's second Pokemon, but it's slower going against Alakazam. The Spoonmaster resists Psychic, so it doesn't deal much damage, but he's also incapable of hitting Lugia with anything that hurts. Gyarados is 4th in line for Blue, and after a few blows of Psychic, a critical hit earns Lugia another knockout. Then comes Arcanine. This is when Blue reverts to his all-time favorite strategy of using money to escape his problems. After 2 full restores, Lugia prevents a 3rd when a Hyrule knocks out the God Dog before Blue can use another item. As Lugia is out of PP for Psychic, we switch in Ho-Oh when Exeggutor enters. We make a switch because of Leech Seed just to be safe, but when Ho-Oh re-enters, it doesn't take long to finish things off. Okay, I genuinely can't believe it, but we've made it to Red. Earning our 8th Kanto gym badge opens up the Mount Silver area, which gives us lots of different options for new Pokemon and moves, although they're all around 30 levels below Red's team. Still, we added a Parasect and a Misdreavus, and we're gonna give this a try. We start the battle with our Quick Claw Parasect against Pikachu and call for Spore. The Quick Claw pops and we make the first move, which was central to my plan. I literally restarted any time we didn't move first. I needed a lot to go right here. Red uses a full restore, but this means we can get off a free Hyper Beam, which I've been saving for this battle. 2 strikes of Thunder land, but Parasect just survives long enough to score the knockout with a second Hyper Beam. We switch out to Snorlax to avoid the recharging period as Red calls on his Venusaur. By starting with Sunny Day, Red sets the battlefield so Venusaur can fire off Solar Beams at will. I mean whenever it wants, not at the annoying Elite Four guy. As a result, Snorlax only lands a single Hyper Beam before fainting. We switch Parasect back in and call for Spore again, with the Quick Claw popping once more. As Venusaur snoozes away, we make another switch out to Lugia and call for the Stab super effective Dream Eater, which I've also been saving. That takes down the fully evolved Grass Starter, and though it may seem a bit odd, when Red sends out Blastoise, we switch in Ho-Oh. The Firebird's got Zap Cannon, and that's our ticket for defeating Blaine. It lands at the first time of asking, paralyzing the Armed Turtle. Another Zap Cannon lands, and although it falls just short of the knockout, we get lucky with Blastoise fully paralyzed once more. Instead of risking another Zap Cannon, we finish the Water type off with a Hyper Beam and then switch out to Misdreavus to avoid the recharging period. It's sad that the Ghost isn't available until the final battle, because there are a lot of moves here that we could have used earlier. Sadly, one Espeon Psychic knocks her out before she can make use of any of them. We bring Parasect back out next, but the Quick Claw doesn't kick in this time, so Espeon takes his tally to 2. We call on Lugia next, knowing there's not a lot that Espeon can do against the partial Psychic type. It takes 3 blasts of Hyper Beam though, which means Lugia is down to 5 hit points by the time the evolution finally goes down. Red Snorlax enters the battle 5th, and we swap Lugia for Suicune. Even though Snorlax's defense isn't particularly high, we're almost 30 levels behind, so Suicune barely leaves a mark. When the Legendary Beast faints, we send out Lugia, but after a single Hyper Beam, it's knocked out too. That leaves only Ho-Oh. We start off with a Zap Cannon to paralyze Snorlax, as Red calls for Amnesia. With only 2 uses of Zap Cannon left, we're forced to go for Hyper Beam because we're going to need those electric moves if we make it to Charizard. A timely critical hit wipes out the remainder of Snorlax's HP, taking us into a one-on-one. As we've got no Pokemon left to switch into, Ho's forced to spend the first turn recharging. Charizard's double dose of Wing Attack cuts away just over half of Ho's HP before a single Zap Cannon proves a little more powerful, leaving Charizard paralyzed and below half health. We only need one more Zap Cannon to land to finish the battle and beat the game, so naturally Ho-Oh misses. Well, in fairness, that one was coming. Charizard connects with Wing Attack again, but leftovers keep us ticking over. A Hyper Beam knocks Charizard out of the air and leaves the fire type deep in red health. In hindsight, Recover would have made a lot more sense, but Wing Attack comes up just short and then Charizard's prevented from attacking by the paralysis. Losing after that mistake would have been pretty painful. Thankfully, Hyper Beam connects one last time, knocking out the Firestarter to hand us the win. Oh my god. That took a really long time. After our win over Red, we'd used a total of 144 moves, which isn't far off the most we really could. There are a ton of moves that are either completely inaccessible or almost totally out of reach in a challenge like this. By the time we made it to the Elite Four, we were running seriously short on moves, and it was the same case when we reached Blue. It actually happened pretty often throughout the challenge. You can make it through battles with 2 or 3 moves left, and that opens up new areas for new Pokemon and new moves. The inability to grind kept things difficult throughout. I'd say over half the battles required multiple attempts because we were so underleveled, but in the end, we got the win. I think it's unlikely that I'll ever revisit this challenge in future games because it's incredibly difficult to plan and keep track of. It's a bit like the bite-only run in that sense. It's a challenge that I don't think anyone else will ever attempt, and I wouldn't recommend they do, but I'm really glad I did, and I'm really happy it's over. So if you made it this far, I really hope you enjoyed. Seriously, thank you so much for watching. And I'll see you next time.